So today I wanted to pick up on a thread that I began with two lectures ago, which is the whole idea of composite bound states. So I've argued that the condor lattice, heavy electrons, can be thought of as the formation of composite fermions between high energy electrons and spin flips. And what I'll argue today is that this kind of process has the potential not only to give rise to heavy fermions, which are renormalized electrons, but it also has the potential to produce new forms of order, new forms of superconducting, and new forms of density wave order. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about the composite pairing hypothesis and how I think it works in the case of some of the 115 heavy electron superconductors. And if time permits, I'll also talk about hastatic order, a hypothesis for the hidden order in uranium, ruthenium 2, silicon 2. Both of these are hypotheses. And what I'm going to start with is talking about a solvable model of composite pairing. And this is a model that has its antecedents in work I did in the late 1990s with Alexis Felik, Hyun P, and Nathan Andre, which is sort of summarized in this visceral B here. And I'll put it in the Dropbox. I'll make a copy of it available for my notes. And then a more recent work in 2008, which is now already 6 years ago, in which we found a way, we discovered basically that we could use this symplectic N approach to describe a controlled version of the composite pairing we discussed in 1999. These more recent papers here, one is with Rebecca Flint about the combination of composite and magnetic pairing. We call it tandem pairing. I won't talk about that today. And the last one here is a discussion of how to include valence fluctuations into all of this, and I also want to talk about that today. So, the kind of condor model that we've been talking about so far can be amply described by fluctuations, valence fluctuations, in one charge channel. So a very nice example would be a cerium 3 plus iron, which undergoes valence fluctuations. Cerium 3 plus iron, which undergoes virtual valence fluctuations by losing an electron and hence becoming a 4 plus iron. This is a F1 configuration, and this is a F0 configuration, and this equilibrium is sort of like that. Okay. And what we've done in writing down the condor model is we've eliminated these high frequency fluctuations by a canonical transformation. That was the Schrieffer-Wolf transformation, and that gives us the two-channel condor model. In the kinds of issues we're going to be talking about today, we're going to be thinking about doublets. In the case of cerium, in, for example, cerium, cobalt, indium 5, this is a tetragonal crystal. And so what that does is it splits the six-fold. What we've had so far is we've discussed how 7 halves and 5 halves are split by something of the order of about 0.6 volts. Now, in a tetragonal environment, these 5 halves states are now split further into 3 Cramer's doublets. Okay? And you can actually measure these Cramer's doublets using neutron scattering or inelastic X-ray scattering. And what are they? These are the states that are invariant under 90 degree rotations. Or provide representations of 90 degree rotation group. It's a triangular group, the C4 group. Okay. And so they're typically labeled gamma 7, there can be a gamma 6, they can be in arbitrary orders, and there's another gamma 7. They're given labels like this. What does this mean? This is alpha times 5 halves. Now, you might think, well, why can't I just have a 5 half state sitting inside a tetragonal crystal? And the reason you can't is that the crystal has 4-fold symmetry. And so as the electrons whiz around inside that 4-fold symmetric environment, they can pick up 4 units of angular momentum, or they can lose 4 units of angular momentum. Angular momentum is only defined mod 4 h bar. Okay? And so 5 halves will never exist on its own. It will add or subtract 4 units of angular momentum. If you subtract 4 units of angular momentum, you get minus 3 halves. And so this state is either plus minus 5 halves or minus plus 3 halves. And there's an orthogonal version, which is beta plus minus 5 halves minus alpha minus plus 3 halves. Okay? And it's almost impossible to have a situation in which alpha is 1 and beta is 0, which would be an Ising spin. Okay? And so generically, Cramer's doublets don't have Ising character. This one would be if the plus or minus a half state. In any one of these plus or minus states, if you apply the operator J plus or minus, it's not equal to 0. It's proportional to alpha beta in this case. Okay? It'll be important later. Okay, so that's what's going on with a one-channel condor model, and it gives rise to a condor lattice with possible insulating or possible heavy electron states. It could also give rise to magnetic solutions. Our kind of mean field theory can't describe those magnetic solutions. But what about the fact that the cerium 3 plus can also add an electron and can excite upwards to a cerium 2 plus state? Okay. You may recall that in the Anderson model, we really have two situations like this. So this would be the 4F0, and this would be the 4F2 state. You can literally measure these states using X-ray photo emission and inverse electron photo emission. So X-ray photo emission plucks an electron out. You can measure this energy. This energy here is about 2 volts. And this energy here, you can't add a hole. Pluck out a hole, but what you can do is add an electron, that's inverse electron photo emission, Bremsstrahlung isochromat spectroscopy, and this energy is about 3 watts in cerium. Okay. And you can literally see, well, when you look at the spectroscopy of these things, you see two features. One is the excitation 4F1 to 4F0, and the other is 4F1. To 4F2. Now, canonically, you would imagine that you can just forget about those higher lying states here when you add an electron, and when you add an electron, you'll go to a 4F2 state just by adding an electron in the same channel you plucked it out. So you might have 2 electrons in the gamma 7 plus state. That would be a singlet state. But what we're interested in is the possibility that the low-lying 4F2 state is not the simple singlet formed by combining a gamma 7 with itself, but a state formed by combining a gamma 7 with, say, a gamma 6 state to form a singlet. Okay? Such a state would then mean that the charge fluctuations in the second channel have a different symmetry to the first. Okay? This would then add a second condor coupling. Now you might say, well, why can't I just add those two together to make one beefed up coupling? And you could certainly do that if both channels have the same symmetry. But hidden in here is this psi 1 dagger. This creates an electron with the symmetry of the gamma 7 plus state. This psi 2 creates an electron with the symmetry of the gamma 6 state. And so as a result, these are two separate condo channels. One is probably weaker than the other, but not by a lot. We can't, this hypothesis, by the way, has not been proven. But the reason we wrote down this model is that this provides the possibility for competition between the condo effect in two separate channels. In a single impurity model, one channel always wins unless you fine-tune J1 to be equal to J2. And in that case, you get a critical point. In the lattice, something more interesting can happen, or equally interesting can happen. The two channels can act cooperatively with one another and can produce composite pairs. And that's what I'm going to try and show you. Okay. Now, as I emphasized last time, the problem with these kinds of models is that we don't have a small parameter. If we write this model using Feynman's path integral method, by the way, Feynman wouldn't have been able to write down a fermionic model as a path integral. You know why? Yes?
I was just going to ask, these electrons,
yes.
There's a conduction band as well.
There's a conduction band as well. Well, yeah, that's the conduction electron there.
Say it again?
That's the conduction band. So here they are. There's the electron conduction band here, right?
But that's what you mean by those transitions.
Yes. So this would be the emission of an electron into the conduction band, and this would be the absorption of an electron into the F state from the conduction band. So this would be the spectral function of the F state. Okay? And this is the condo resonance around zero, that's the heavy band. Okay? Why couldn't Feynman write down a path integral for fermionic models? Is there, he didn't know about Grassmann. Actually, oh dear.
Sorry, I meant to answer this. Hello.
Thank you.
Good. Bye bye.
That's my appointment. So it turned out, actually Schringer was the first person to realize that you can actually reformulate a fermionic problem using coherent states of fermions, which are Grassmanns. That's what we're going to be doing here. Now, the problem with this is that there's no small parameter, and so the quantum fluctuations in this path integral are not controlled anyway. Their fluctuations gone wild. And worse still, in these kinds of models, you can't do recoupling in J1 or J2 because you have condo logs, which show that they scale to strong coupling. And so what we're going to do is we're going to pursue the suggestion of Finn Anderson, which is to try and do a large N expansion on such a model. And as I discussed, the point is we're going to generalize the number of spin components from 2 to N. Okay?
Yes, you may want to...
Turn off the. Yeah. Still not very good, but anyway, okay. And now, as I discussed last time, so what that does is it makes the action grow extensively with n, and what this does is that it behaves as if you've got a Planck's constant of order 1 over n. It calms down the wild fluctuations and makes them condense around a mean field theory. And if you're lucky, that mean field theory has something to do with the case with n equals 2. Now, as we discussed last time, the representation of the spin operator is very important. And what we're going to use is the symplectic representation of the spin operator, which permits us to consider not only particle-hole pairs, but also particle-particle pairs as singlets of the SPN group that this describes. Okay. And so that's what we're going to do. Okay. This morning as I scrambled to write down a few notes, I took a camera shot of them to save me time writing them on the blackboard. So let me run you through how this works. Okay. So there's the spin. I think you can just about read that. I can do this on the blackboard, but if it doesn't work, we'll keep going. There's the spin operator. And that's not going to work. I'm going to write it on the blackboard together. could make that bigger, but we don't think that concerns more petty budget anyway. So the spin operator, as we discussed, last time, takes this form, okay? And the reason it has these particle hole transformed terms here is that this spin operator here commutes.
So the sine of alpha to the
here. Yeah, and so alpha tilde here is my shorthand notation.
Okay.
And here alpha runs from minus n over 2 to plus n over 2. So it's really just n over 2 copies of spin up, spin down. And so our Hamiltonian we're going to be looking at is the condom model. And we're going to now add in two channels with strength J gamma coupling to, I used the notation of psi earlier, so let's use it here. And these fermions here, psi, j, alpha, yes, these fermions here create electrons in a local Wannier state, and so this is 1 over the number of sites in the system, sum over k, of some c of k of sigma, and then I'll have some form factor here, which generically is not even diagonal in spin, because of spin orbit coupling. That's the model, and the other thing I have to know is that I need to choose a representation of the spin operator, of the spin. And so what we're going to do is to choose that the number of particles is exactly equal to n by 2. And furthermore, we're going to impose the SUN constraint, the SU2 constraint, which, let me just, so that's what we're going to, that's the model. And let me give you a little bit more notation that I will be using. I'll also be introducing a Nambu notation. When I switch to Nambu, I'll put tildes in. Okay? So F tilde J sigma will actually mean F J sigma F J minus sigma dagger sine of sigma. That's what it will mean. Okay? That's the Nambu notation. And we're going to be imposing the constraint that F tilde tau, F tilde, equals 0. This is the constraint associated with that spin operator. Okay? What does that mean? That means the diagonal term, F tilde tau 3, F tilde, is nothing, and this I've got to put this spin index in here, and sum over sigma positive. Well, it doesn't really matter, but this constraint here just gives me F dagger the ups minus F, and that's nothing more than, since this sums over half of them, than NF minus N over 2. So that constraint imposes NF equal to N over 2. But the other constraint that's equally important is F sigma F minus sigma dagger equals 0. Okay? These are all the requirements that come from imposing the constraint that the problem should be SU2 invariant. Okay? And this basically means it's an SU2 singlet, an SU2 charge singlet, which means it's invariant under particle hole rotations.
One quick question.
Yes.
So when you wrote tau vector, so you mean this is true for each of tau 1, tau 2?
Yes, that's right. So tau is tau 1, tau 2, tau 3. Okay? So this is, yes, so this means no S wave pairing on the F side is another way of looking at it. Yes.
Is there a spin orbit interaction?
Well, all the spin orbit coupling is buried in sigma, in phi here, okay? If I make phi here to be a diagonal matrix, then there's no spin orbit coupling in my problem.
In sigma alpha.
In the sigma alpha. If big phi here is diagonal, there's no spin orbit coupling. However, this is still not very clear there. So without spin orbit, I'm gonna blow that up. I really thought you'd really see it. So without spin orbit coupling, the phi that comes in here might be a simple model, would be phi 1 is just delta alpha beta, and phi 2, in other words, S wave, and phi 2 alpha beta is cosine x minus cosine y delta alpha beta, that would be D wave. That's a toy model, but a more realistic model would take into account the spin-orbit coupling intrinsic to the F states, which really have an infinite spin-orbit coupling acting on them, as I mentioned last time. So to construct, this is no spin-orbit coupling, but to construct the phi with spin-orbit coupling, what we would do is, this is phi with spin orbit coupling, really is an overlap of a plane wave state with spin, let me call it sigma, with a crystal field state with spin component beta. That's what that guy is. It's the overlap. Now, to expand that out, you have to expand that out step by step by putting intermediate states in here. So if there were no spin orbit coupling, and this were just an F state with L equals 3, this would just give you some YL LM of K. But in fact, you've got to now expand this out when this case, because let's just do the expansion. First of all, this K state has to be projected onto a state with L equals 3. And a given value of m, and I'm going to choose that value of m m minus sigma. I'll come back to that in a moment. The point being, let me come back to that in a moment. And then, let me put this m prime here, m prime there, okay? And then I have to have a Clebsch-Gordan coefficient that combines m prime and half sigma with a J equals 5 half state, and now here I have to put some M prime in here, okay? And then I have some M prime overlap with the crystal field state beta. Okay? There'd be two summations here, sum over M and sum over M prime. Now, this is nothing more than the spherical harmonic going here. This term here is a Clebsch-Gordan coefficient, which I can never remember, but the important point is that m plus sigma must equal m prime, okay, in the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient. And therefore, I can rewrite this, this overlap function here in terms of so that now becomes phi gamma of sigma beta of k equals y 3 m minus sigma of k, a Clebsch-Gordan coefficient n equals 3 m minus sigma one half sigma, have I got this right, J equals 5/2 sigma, and now I'll have my coefficients of my sigmas onto my betas, my gamma betas here. Now I made a mistake there, this is M prime. And this is M prime. Yeah, so that's the form of this function. And basically it's determined uniquely by the crystal field coefficients here. So for example, if I take the gamma 6 beta on sigma, this is nothing more than delta beta sigma. Okay, it's where sigma is equal to plus or minus 1/2. M prime here is equal to delta beta M prime. Well, it's equal to 1 if M prime equal beta equals plus or minus 1/2. Because gamma 6 is just plus or minus 1/2. But if I take the gamma 7, this is then a linear comp, this is then alpha or beta. Okay? So that's my long-winded answer to what that coefficient means. Okay? And so the next thing is to rewrite the interaction using this symplectic form, and there's a dagger missing from here. And if I now expand that out, I then find, and I'll write it on the blackboard because it's obviously not clear enough, that I get a coupling in two channels, a Kondo coupling in the particle-hole channel, and an equal amount of Kondo coupling in the particle-particle channel. Now you might, let's just look at that. So our interaction now becomes J, and I've got the 2N, I'm just going to keep the N. J over 2N, I don't know why over 2N. CJ alpha, CJ beta, and now my spin operator, S beta alpha of J, will now take the form FJ beta, FJ alpha. That's just the SUN form, but now plus the sine of alpha beta times F minus beta, F minus alpha dagger. So now if I expand that out, I throw away terms that come I think I just expand it out, just anti-commuting through, I get minus J over 2N, and then the first term is the hybridization term, and the second term is the pairing term. Okay, now I can fill in all the indices on this. Alpha, alpha, beta, beta, alpha, minus beta, beta. There's an alpha tilde, beta tilde coming in there, and I've got J's everywhere. And to be consistent with my early notation, this should be psi. Okay. So now, if we do a Hubbard's, and this is very much like the inter-site coupling we saw yesterday in doing magnetism. If we now decouple that using a Hubbard-Stoltz decoupling, the first term gives me exactly what I was used to before, psi dagger F times V plus some Hermitian conjugate plus V bar V J over. Let's throw the two away. J times N. That's the first term. And the second term is then some delta. Let me write it out explicitly, because V bar F dagger C. And the second term is psi dagger F dagger plus F dagger plus F psi times delta bar. Okay, times another term, N delta bar delta over J. Okay? So because this is a neutral spin, it doesn't know whether it's a particle or a hole. And so it can't choose whether it should pair in the particle hole or the particle particle channel. That's the SU2 symmetry. Okay. Now, looking at this, you should start to chuckle. You should say, well, very good, but this shows exactly the problem I've been telling you about for ages with these mean field methods. You've just concluded that the Condor model gives rise to superconductivity, and everybody knows that the single impurity Condor model doesn't have anything of the sort. Okay? Take this off. Oh, poor children. Excuse me. Paul? Paul, I'm in the middle of a lecture. Can I call you back in an hour? Okay, cheers, bye. Oh, thanks very much. Bye. Good busy day. Okay, so let's turn this off. What's the chalk on it? Yeah, so...
Another question.
Yeah, hang on, let me just turn this on.
Question
Okay, yes.
So, just to clarify why we're getting decoupling in the particle-particle channel in
yes.
this model but not the previous one?
In the S, yes.
So, yeah, so I mean, if I just, so previously I had just that first
Just term, the first term,
just
yes.
Just the first term and not the second.
Yes.
So I could, formally I could connect psi dagger, f dagger.
Yes.
Right? So what's the difference?
Well, in the large end, you could, of course, you could have done that, you could have connected psi dagger with f dagger here, but you'd have alpha times beta coming in there.
Okay, so,
right? So that would be a kind of matrix decoupling of the operator and would not give you a good large end limit. Okay, this decoupling is dictated by the large end limit. Okay, so if we just had this term here, the term, I'm looking for terms that grow extensively with n. Okay? And so these two terms here will grow extensively with n. If I decoupled it in some kind of tensor channel, which of course I'm allowed to do, the mean field theory in that would now have n squared terms, and you wouldn't get a good large n limit with that kind of decoupling. Okay? Another way of saying it is that with this model, in the large n limit, these bilinears behave as classical variables. So it's natural to decouple them in that channel. Now, because I've chosen SPN, which allows the possibility of particle-hole singlets, as we discussed last time, I also get these additional terms coming in here. Okay? And so I must also decouple those equally. Okay? And so the large limit dictates how I should decouple this interaction. Okay? Of course, there's a multitude of ways of doing it, and that's exactly why we want to go to a larger limit. We want to go to a limit where there's no ambiguity about the way we should treat the Lagrangian.
Okay. When you say there's no ambiguity about the way we should treat it, does that mean that if you decoupled in one of these tensor ways
yes.
and did the mean field theory, etc., you always find a higher ground state energy than the appropriate decoupling in the...
The problem would be, just think of it offhand, when you have tensor objects in large M theories, you have an example of the kind of theory you're dealing with in QCD, where the tensor is the gluon, which contains two quarks inside it, right? And when you start to draw the diagrams for those things, what you find is that all the planar diagrams have exactly the same contribution. And so what happens is that you, at least until recently, you couldn't resum those diagrams. And no one knew what to do with them. This is an example of a vector large N theory in which the exchange bosons don't carry an index. And so in such large, that's basically an RPA theory. Okay. So in such large N theories, it's very clear that the dominant diagrams are just the RPA diagrams. And when those RPA fluctuations condense, you produce your mean field theory. And so in this theory, those RPA fluctuations would exist equally in the particle hole and the particle-particle channel. Okay. So if you started to draw diagrams for this, we could just do diagrammatics with this, right? And what we would find is that we have two types of coupling, one that looks like this. That would be the first term, And the second term would now be two particles coming in like this. Maybe we give that a different symbol. Okay? Right. Both with equal amounts of amplitudes. And so each of these would give J over N in the diagrammatics. Okay? So if I start to resum, I've got to balance off my 1 over N's with my loops. And so I immediately develop an RPA in the particle hole and a particle-particle channel. What then happens as I cool down is that those RPA bosons develop a singularity, and I get a phase transition into a broken symmetry state. That is then the large N mean field theory that we're now exploring.
Okay.
And
the channels don't talk to each other at this level, right?
At this level, they don't talk to one another, but what is so, for, yeah, locally they don't talk to one another, right? Of course, they don't talk, well, they don't talk to one another because they have, one is neutral, one is charged. Okay?
We can talk offline, yeah. But I guess what my confusion is it's clear that these types of decouplings are cleaner, more straightforward, but it's not obvious to me that they're necessarily energetically better. And since I'm doing mean field theory, like the
So what I was trying to show you is writing this diagrammatic like this is completely unambiguous. Is completely unambiguous. This is the perturbation theory. Okay, right. So if I now write down all possible perturbation theory diagrams, what I'll see is that the diagrams that dominate are the ones where, if I want to produce, let me just look at an exchange. Just look at a few diagrams that come in to here, just to illustrate the point. Supposing you wanted to look at scattering of an electron off the local moment, okay? So then you'd have two different, so we could start to, we're really interested in this process here, okay? This thing is then divided into two terms. It has this term, plus it also has, and I'm going to get myself mixed up here, it also has the term where this comes through, that's the particle hole channel, and I've got to do the particle. So, I'm going to get them mixed up now. I want to form a particle hole, so I want to do that. I'm going to get mixed up here. The point is it has two channels of interaction, both are of strength 1 over n. So now I want to look at all terms that give me the same power of 1 over n. So one example, here is a one such correction in the particle hole channel, particle-particle channel. Here's another such correction in the particle hole channel. Okay? These both give me 1 over n, 1 over n, 1 over n, 1 over n. But this gives me n, this loop here. And this also gives me n here. So these contribute as much as the bare terms. Okay? So if I want to calculate the leading order of 1 over n, the interaction, the enormous interaction, I must sum all the bubble diagrams. Now let's look at the tensor term that would come in, which would be like this. Okay? Well, these have different spin indices here. Okay, could also do a part of the whole thing. Now this has got 1 over n, 1 over n, but there's no loop sum here. So this term is of order 1 over n squared. Okay? And if you dared to start trying to look at singular terms where you resum those, okay, you'd find that each order is 1 over n still lower. And so it would not contribute in the large n limit. Okay? So in the large n limit, there's absolutely no ambiguity that this is the only decoupling channel that's going to condense. And that's because the bilinears, psi dagger f and psi dagger f dagger, behave as semi-classical variables in the large n limit, whereas the tensor objects do not. They continue to behave as quantum variables. Okay? This is really important. That's the reason why you want to. This may have nothing to do with reality, but it's a controlled treatment of the theory. Okay. So when you take this and write, you can write this in a slightly more elegant way, you can write it as a tensor, sorry, as a matrix formulation. And what you now have, if you look at these terms that are coming in here, you have a particle hole and a particle particle term. And so it's very natural to write that in a kind of Nambu notation as the interaction now as, again, a sum over sigmas greater than zero. Now I put in my Nambu type coupling, and now I can write V. Here is my psi dagger J coming in there. So that's the diagonal term. Since I've thrown away the minus sigma terms, I put a minus V bar here and put psi J minus sigma dagger there. Okay, and now I can put in the other terms, delta and delta bar. This plus its Hermitian conjugate, and now I also have plus N over J, and the trace of this object with itself, V bar, delta minus V, with V delta, delta bar minus V bar. So that's the decoupling of the Kondo interaction in this SPN method. Okay? Where basically the hybridizations are the diagonal components of this SU2 matrix, and the pairs are on the off diagonals. And so having done this, we can now write this elegantly using a Nambu notation, and the conclusion is that our interaction here can now be rewritten. And let us call this matrix V, this thing here, let's call this curly V. Okay. So now I'm going to rewrite all of this as F tilde J sigma V curly times psi J sigma plus Hermitian conjugate plus N over J trace V curly dagger. That is the rewritten version of this interaction. Okay? Right? So this is the Hubbard-Sorovich transform version of this thing here. And so now we've gone from the original F notation to the tilde notation, which is the Nambu notation. Okay? And what you can see about this, and what my next line was, isn't it? What you can see about this is that it has a local SU2 symmetry associated with it. Okay. And in particular, I can always make transformations where I take psi and multiply by U times psi, where U is an SU2 matrix, and take V curly and multiply that by U times V curly. And under this transformation, this should have a dagger there. That's how it should look. Under this transformation, so where here, V curly, and I want to go back to my notation here, I think that's right there. No, there's no dagger here, right. Where V here is V minus V delta bar. So under these SU2 transformations, this interaction is invariant. So this is an SU2 gauge theory. And so there it is, that's the final answer. Now we've got two channels and two interactions here. So now, if I have just one channel, I can always gauge fix my problem. Let's just say I can always rotate so that the V here is on the diagonal. And then I've just gotten back to a hybridization form of the problem. But if I have two channels, for now summing over two channels here, then I have to put in one of these V curlies for each channel. And whereas I can always gauge fix one of the channels to be diagonal in the particle hole basis, I can't do it for both of them. And consequently, generically, The introduction of two channels in this mean field procedure leads to a broken symmetry.
Sorry, why can't I do separate unitary transformations on the two channels?
Because they share one F electron. Okay, that's why. Okay. So I can always. So the upshot of all of that is that I then can put all of my ignorance about the broken symmetry into the second channel, if I like, and keep the first channel hybridizing happily as part of a whole. So let's look at what happens if I choose V channel 1 equal to V0, 0, okay? And V channel 2 equal to 0, 0, delta bar. Then my mean field theory, my interaction, then looks like sum over each side j. And what I'm going to get here is f dagger v at side j, coupling into psi channel 1 j. Sorry, so this is then equal to v tau 3. And this is equal to, let me just keep these to be real, delta tau 1. So then my H interaction will then look like F dagger, I can write it as V1 psi 1 plus V2 psi 2 plus summation conjugate. And this then becomes F tilde dagger J V times tau 3 psi 1 plus delta F tilde J tau 1 times psi tilde 2 plus summation conjugate plus V squared over J1 plus delta squared over J2. And schematically what this means is the following, is that if you have just one channel in the problem, then the electron resonantly scatters through the F state. It comes along. Here is my V. It comes through the F state. And now it comes out as an F electron, as a conduction electric gate. This is the resonance scattering of one channel. And of course, if I wanted to, I could have rotated this into the particle-particle channel. It would have made no difference. I would have called it delta. And I've got this coming along. I've got an anomalous scattering event and another anomalous scattering event. And it would have come out as the same electron it went in. So it wouldn't have broken any gauge symmetry. Okay. However, if I now have two channels, then this is coming in channel one. If I have two channels, I come in channel one. I scatter through V into the F state. But now something weird happens, I Andreev scatter out into the second channel. And so I get an anomalous scattering between channel 1 and channel 2. And so this process is what generates anomalous Andreev reflection off a condo impurity. And it's this process that produces the composite pairing. Notice that the net amplitude is proportional to V times delta. And this is the composite order parameter. The composite order parameter is equal to the product of these two channels. This is V in channel 1 becomes delta in channel 2. And a more careful analysis shows that this diagram is actually proportional to V in channel 1 times delta in channel 2 minus V in channel 2 delta in channel 1. And so this is resonant Andreev reflection of the condo impurity. Okay. Now if you play the game with this model for just a single impurity, you discover that the strongest channel always wins. And so what happens is that you get two different Fermi liquids separated by a critical point that separates the two points. Okay? And this point where J1 equals J2, you can rotate continuously from one channel into the other. That is then the critical state associated with the two-channel Kondo problem. However, if you now take, and there's a lot known about the two-channel Kondo model, and one of the things I want to draw your attention to is the fact that in the two-channel Kondo model, where you don't have a well-defined Fermi liquid ground state, you have a lot of singular composite pair fluctuations present, and a lot of singular composite fluctuations in general, and you can actually calculate using various methods the susceptibility, the pair susceptibility of a single impurity model. Now, when you go to the lattice, something interesting happens, because the system can now avoid this, because whereas in one on one side, the two channels are completely orthogonal to one another, in a lattice, the two channels share a common Fermi surface. And so an electron coming out in channel one at site two can enter in channel one at site one. And what this leads to is the possibility of a Cooper instability, an anomalous Cooper instability, and what actually happens is that the phase diagram ends up looking like this. You end up having Fermi liquid in channel 1, which is when just V is present, or Fermi liquid in channel 2, which is when delta is just present. But in between these two states is a phase transition into a composite paired state where you have both V and delta present, and you get superconductivity. You can calculate a lot of properties in this state, but I'm not going to go into it. You can diagonalize the Hamiltonian analytically. You can then write down mean field equations. You can calculate the superfluid stiffness. And one of the interesting things I wanted to remark on is that the superfluid stiffness contains two terms. It contains a BCS term, but it also contains a term associated with the composite pairs. And that's because there's a current associated with these form factors. The form factors have a K dependence, and so when you differentiate those form factors, you get an additional contribution to the current. And this is because the composite pairs themselves can actually move, and you can regard them as actually being bosons in their own right. Okay. Another remark on this is that and this was discovered by us in this early paper in 99 or 98, is that you can actually find a regime of parameters in which the Kondo insulator is unstable to superconductivity. And that's very interesting because you then can produce a superconductor which has no underlying Fermi surface, but which nevertheless may have a non-trivial symmetry. And the last remark I wanted to make is that the symmetry of the pair is determined by basically the product of the symmetries of the gap of the two channels. If we have gamma 6 and gamma 7, then the product of 6 times 7 is 42. And as you know from Douglas Adams, 42 is always the answer to the unknown question. That's why we like this choice. But actually, joking aside, turns out that these two channels differ by 2 units of angular momentum. And so this gives you basically a D-wave form factor. Okay? And so if you did a very simple solution, which you chose by hand, phi 1, phi 6 to be S-wave and phi 7 to be D-wave, you'd also get D-wave. But it actually happens that because when you enter in one channel and you come out in the other, you lose 2 units of angular momentum, you get a D-wave order parameter. So I'm just going to go. How much time do I have now?
We have about 25 minutes.
25 minutes, yeah. Questions? Yes?
Sorry, can you repeat the
critical
part before and after you introduce the crystal field, the crystal
diagram? Yes, so if you're just stupid and you just calculate your mean field theory, the question was, can you repeat the remarks about the criticality that's present in the impurity but absent in the lattice. Is that correct? Yes, okay, well, so, okay, I'll do that. The difference between the impurity and the lattice is twofold. But the most important one is that two can never become one. So what's the right way of doing this? I think the easiest way the point is that an electron leaving in channel 2 always has to come back in channel 2 in an impurity. It can never switch channels. it always has the same symmetry because there's a local symmetry around one side. The partial wave states are all decoupled. So if an electron comes out in channel 2, it might try to do this, but actually I guess the point is the following. If V1 is finite, delta 2 never goes critical in the impurity problem, because the effect of the hybridization in channel 1 creates a mass for delta 2 and prevents it from condensing. But in the case of the lattice, what actually happens is that channel 1 and channel 2 are no longer distinct from one another. And so if I look at, here's the point, delta 2 couples to this vertex. And so if I want to calculate its instability, in the singular impurity model, I would just do the following. I would have to calculate all the bubble diagrams that connect, this is channel 1, this is channel 2, yeah? And I have to calculate all possible diagrams that look like this. This is the Gaussian contribution to the action in channel 2. And so I'm looking for when this Gaussian coefficient of delta 2 squared goes to 0. This term here gives me a contribution which is negative, but never large enough for compensating this term here unless J2 is bigger than J1. Whereas by contrast, in the lattice, the point is that 2 is now mixed with, in the lattice, this is now momentum conserving that comes in here. And so this instability here always has the Cooper log associated with it. And that log always forces this term here to become divergently negative. And so you always get an instability in which delta 2 develops even if V1 is present. And that's why, in the lattice case, I always get a Cooper. Another way of saying it is that the second channel coupling provides an attractive coupling for the quasiparticles in channel 1. Okay? And so down here, all the way down here on the left-hand side, I have nothing more than a conventional Cooper instability here from a Fermi liquid. But as I come close to the region where J1 and J2 are very similar to one another, I have a direct transition from a Curie paramagnet into a superconductor. So we think that systems like neptunium, palladium, aluminium lie very close to this region where the two channels are very equal in their strength. And so I want to contrast the real space structure of a composite D-wave pair with a conventional D-wave pair. So a conventional D-wave pair involves nearest neighbor sites. These could be nearest neighbor cerium sites or nearest neighbor copper sites. Whereas, and it's very sensitive to pair breaking. By contrast, if you form a composite pair, it lives within a single unit cell. And it's an intracell boson, so that if I kill this local moment here, take it out, I destroy the pair in this cage, but I don't affect the pairs on neighboring sites. And so for this reason, the effect of on-site disorder in a composite pair is much less than on-site disorder in an extended regular D-wave pair. And this may be part of the reason why, when you dope cerium cobalt indium 5 with a terbium, you have extreme resilience to the disorder. You can go all the way out to 60% replacement of cobalt by a terbium, and TC is coming down beautifully linearly here. This is also because the terbium provides charge fluctuations which compensate for the loss of the cerium. And one of the things that has come to light recently is that when you measure the penetration depth of cerium, ytterbium, cobalt, indium 5 beyond about 20%, it appears as if the system has become fully gapped. The penetration depth no longer has the classic T-squared behavior of a D-wave superconductor, but actually looks like it's fully gapped at much higher power law. And this may be because in this particular system, what you're doing is you're actually forming what would we might regard as a composite paired condo insulator. Let me just show you a few more things about this. One of the interesting things about a composite pair is that because it uses two different channels, it changes the charge distribution around it. So when you form a composite pair, you have a quadrupolar distribution of charge that's modified and proportional to the strength of the order parameter squared. And this then means that if you strain your lattice, you'll get a large linear coupling to TC. And one of the fascinating things about these systems is that strain, strain couples. Strain is known to couple, or C-axis strain is known to couple to TC very strongly.
How do you know the sign of lambda?
You don't know the sign of lambda.
So the way it goes.
The way it goes, it is at least at this level ambiguous. Yeah. Okay. But one of the things that has been long a puzzle for these systems, these different families, is that you can plot their TC versus the C-axis strain. This has been long interpreted as the advantages of dimensionality. You can interpret this that the highest TCs are the most two-dimensional. Okay? But another way of interpreting that is that you've got a very strong, these may not be incompatible with one another, a very strong coupling of the strain to the TC. Another aspect to this is that you expect that the charge distribution will actually change as superconductivity goes up. Yes?
Sir, before you go on, any superconductor should be able to couple in that way to see how it's a strain, right?
No. Okay. So for example, in the cuprates, you don't change the charge distribution by forming a D-wave pair.
So I'm not talking about I'm not talking about microscopics right now, I'm talking just phenomenologically.
It's not forbidden by symmetry.
It's not forbidden, but there's a reason in this case that you'd expect it to be a large coefficient.
Right. So this is a microscopic aspect of the problem in some sense. The other aspect is that you expect the one way of measuring charge distributions is to do nuclear quadrupole resonance measurements. And nuclear quadrupole resonance, the frequency is proportional to the gradient of the, it's proportional to the electric field strength, like the gradient of the electric field strength. And so you expect a shift in the nuclear quadrupole resonance signal as a function of the order parameter squared microscopically. And so since we made this prediction, there have been a number of efforts to look at the NQR signals. And these are the NQR signals measured in two of the plutonium 115 systems as they go superconducting. The coefficient here is within a factor of 10 of our estimates, but not better than that. Last but not least on this particular subject, this is the penetration depth seen in ytterbium doped cerium cobalt indium 5. And one of the interesting things is that when you put lanthanum in, it's just like a disordered D-wave superconductor. It crosses over from linear to T-squared behavior. This is because the disorder fills in the nodes. But when you put ytterbium in, what happens is that rather than crossing over to N equals 2, it becomes the experimental fit goes to a much higher power. And that's usually a sign of exponential relaxation. And so the experimentalists interpret this as the formation of a gap in the quasiparticle spectrum as you dope it with ytterbium. And that poses the question because you would say, well, if it's become fully gapped, then maybe these were accidental nodes that you had in the first place. But actually, the nodes are known to have a D-wave character from various other measurements, and so there can be no accidental nodes. And so another interpretation of this phenomenon is that when you're doping with a terbium, you're shifting yourself over from a cerium-based hole-like Fermi surface to an ytterbium-based electron-like Fermi surface. And in between the two, you go through a phase where there is no longer a Fermi surface on which you've got any pairing, and you remain superconducting because of the presence of the composite pairs. And this was something that was actually predicted in the early composite pair models, and we may have an actual realization of it now. So that's the kind of phase diagram that comes out of the composite pairing model. This is work that I've done with Ona Erten and Rebecca Flint.
So in the meantime, there can be no nodes because there's no Fermi
surface. There's no Fermi surface, yeah. So this is something that may be possible to detect using STM measurements. And I just want to end with one last remark, something I just don't understand at all, which puzzles me immensely. In the cuprates and in the nictites, you see neutron resonance structures at pi pi or pi pi pi. And these are thought to be resonances that are produced by the interplay of magnetic fluctuations and the superconducting gap. And they should be spin one excitations. But you can't tell they're spin one because you need to put such large fields on these systems that you can never get to the point where you have a field large enough to be larger than the width of the excitation. But in cerium cobalt indium 5, the width of the excitation is sufficiently narrow that you can actually apply a magnetic field and split it apart. And one of the interesting aspects of this resonance is that it splits into two, not into three. And I think this is an enduring puzzle at the moment. I don't want to spend any more time on that, but I just mention it as a rather fascinating feature of this resonance. Of course, crystal fields can, in principle, split a triplet into a doublet and a singlet, and maybe that's what we're seeing here. When you go into the details, it's not possible to explain this detail, this linear coupling in the way it's actually seen. So this is an interesting open question. So I could stop here. I've spent a bit of time trying to show you and how one can attempt to put together a composite paired model of the heavy electron superconductors. This does not preclude magnetic pairing, but it's probably an important part of the story. In fact, magnetic pairing likes composite pairing. They're both D-wave order parameters. Their coupling constants reinforce one another. And so there's no reason at all why you can't have both order parameters coexistent, and in fact enhancing one another to produce a TC that's larger than either one in isolation. The other aspect of this is, I think, is quite interesting because it's really superconductivity driven by the Kondo effect. It's really the Kondo effect in two channels conspiring to produce new forms of order. And you could equally well look at this and produce a pneumatic kind of order. In fact, the pneumatic order is what's produced when you take V1 in channel 1 and V2 in channel 2. That produces a pneumatic order parameter. This is very interesting because it would at first then look as if you had a multipolar order parameter produced by the scattering in the two channels. Okay. But actually the underlying physics would be neither connected with one channel or the other channel. It would actually be the consequence of an interference between the composite heavy fermions in the two channels. And so one of the interesting questions is whether we can find examples of this kind of order occurring in other systems. And if I have a few minutes left, I'd like to tell you why I think uranium-ruthenium-2-silicon-2, which has a hidden order parameter, might be an example of such a phenomenon. But if we have lots of questions on this, we can just stay here.
Yeah, maybe before you go to the last subject, since Pierce and Oath and you will be leaving
today and will not be present in the question and answer session. If you have questions about all four lectures, just it's a time to ask.
Yeah, you could also email me, of course.
Yeah, sure. But it's better for us. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah.
Could you say again how your microscopic model for this how strain affects TC leads to this sharp change in TC of strain?
Well, I probably can't give you an explanation at the level you want to have it, because we haven't done any detailed calculations. But the important point about this is that the reason that the parameter would be much larger than a conventional superconductor is that because there are two channels of different symmetry involved in forming the composite pair, as you switch one on, in some sense you are redistributing the charge as a result of forming the pair. Whereas if you just had a conventional D-wave superconductor, there's no charge redistribution associated with the pairing. But in this case, there's actually a change of valence and a change of charge distribution around the site. So those effects will couple to the lattice. And if you like, there's actually a quadrupole moment associated with the underlying order parameter. That quadrupole moment, it doesn't break any symmetry, but it does couple to the strain. And so it's more a question of, generically, we wouldn't expect the order parameter to couple to strain at all. Whereas in the BCS limit, whereas in this problem, we do expect such a coupling.
This is what you meant
about
going on to a 2D limit when TC was high?
Yeah, so, as I said, I don't think I can answer the question at the level you'd like it to be answered. It was mainly remarked that this provides an alternative interpretation of these linear curves that have been long interpreted as the effect of dimensionality. It is an interesting question whether we can actually produce the specific gradients. What you need to do to really pin that down is you need to know how the parameters of the microscopic model depend on strain. And then you then input that to calculate how TC depended on strain. Okay. But it is an interesting point. You might be able to do something by it's an interesting question of how to distinguish between dimensionality effects and strain effects. I don't know a simple way of doing that.
What about in-plane strain?
Yes.
Would that couple with
the... Well, in-plane strain, we're always coupled by the Poisson ratio to out-of-plane strain. If you squeeze this way, it's like pulling that way.
Okay, but I'm saying in the sense that it's a great tetragonal symmetry. There's not...
Oh, I see. This order parameter doesn't depend on tetragonal symmetry. What that would do, however, is it would affect the crystal field states. It would change their character. And so that is interesting because what that would do is change the symmetry of the pair, if this were the case. Because the crystal fields are intimately connected with the pair symmetry. And so, but I don't know offhand what that would do in detail to physics.
Since you mentioned Newton resonance,
yes,
is there any understanding what generates the feedback from this composite training on electrons? For example, if you look at susceptibility bubble, how it's affected by...
Yeah, that's a very good question. One of the reasons I've shied away from that is that I have to go phenomenological to discuss such a thing, because we've decoupled in singlet channels the interactions. And now, to do the sorts of things people do, actually in all cases, what is done is that you say, okay, well, we've got this magnetic interaction, we thought about it producing pairing, but now let's also think about the fluctuations in the magnetic channel. So one could try and do that, and you could calculate the pair bubble, the spin bubble, and couple it to the magnetic coupling. And what is the specific, one could do that calculation.
What part of this excitonic resonance story is that even without any interaction, you calculate the bubble in the D-wave superconductor, and you need to find the real part of the bubble diverges, and this is basically the origin of excitonic peak. So yes. Can anything like this be done in this case?
Sure. Yeah, so the reason, without putting feedback in, you could definitely calculate the bubble. And I don't see why it would. It's a good question whether it would have any qualitative differences from what you've just described. And I don't know the answer to that.
But you can introduce an analog of Kirchhoff's anomalous green function.
Yes. So yeah. And, absolutely. And I, in fact, these terms, as I mentioned earlier, you can kind of think of these as an anomalous self-energy produced by the Kondo scattering. And so the Green's function for the conduction electrons has the normal form here, but now what you have is an anomalous hybridization. That produces an anomalous Green's function, and so this is the generic form of the pairing. Well, this is what replaces the gap function of a conventional superconductor.
And composite nature is where?
The composite nature is coming because the pairing in this comes from the combination of the two channels. So the anomalous part of this self-energy comes from the product of the hybridization in channel 1 with the hybridization in channel 2. So, but this kind of self-energy can also produce other forms of broken symmetry. In particular, if you have a staggered component to the Kondo interaction, you can now produce novel forms of charge density wave. Okay? Yeah, so that was my.
Sorry. For this composite pairing mechanism, what is the reason for J1 and J2 to be close to each other?
Well,
they're not related by symmetry.
They're not related by symmetry in this particular case. I think the only answer we would give to that is that the energies for adding an electron and removing an electron are roughly comparable with one another. Of course, we don't know that the second channel involves an electron of a different symmetry to the first channel. And it raises an interesting question, unfortunately, because inverse photoemission spectroscopy is so poorly developed compared with ARPA spectroscopy. It would be very interesting if one could actually do a high energy probe in that channel and actually try and look at the symmetries associated with adding an electron to go to the excited state. But that's a weakness of our theory. It doesn't come naturally. It has to be put in by hand.
And can you remind me the empirical phase diagram for this kind of superconductor? Is it close to a neo state?
Close to a?
A neo state?
So as I mentioned at the very beginning, these kinds of mean field theories can't answer that question.
I mean experimental.
Oh, experimentally, yeah, okay.
Maybe we can just sketch.
Yeah, so
it'll be easier.
Yeah, it'll be easier to sketch. Mm-hmm. So, in fact, the answer is that it depends. Sometimes it's close and sometimes it's not close. So, if I remember, I prefer to draw it, not to draw it, because I wanted to show the actual data, excepting my computer's gone to sleep. Oh, there it is. So the answer is that in the plutonium compound, there's no nearby magnetism. But in the cerium compound, depending on the amount of rhodium in the problem, you can actually get it to go magnetic. And you do see superconductivity at the bounds of magnetism. Now I'm sort of reminding myself here. So the rhodium case has a 5 Kelvin, antiferromagnetic dome around it. You need to put pressure on it. The cobalt case is actually a superconductor at 2.5 Kelvin. And the iridium case is a superconductor at something like 2 Kelvin. And so the interesting thing is that in between cobalt and iridium, there's no sign of any magnetism there. Whereas there is this, so there's a, between rhodium and cobalt, there is signs of superconductivity on the edge of magnetism. But as you go up, I think actually iridium is actually larger. The iridium is further away from magnetism and it has a higher TC. I wanted to just show you that. My computer has just decided to go to sleep, so yeah, forget about that for a second. Okay, I need to wake it up if I'm going to do any more, though. Yeah, I do have it here.
Okay, while Pierce is trying to put his computer back to work, more questions. Right? One and two. Good. Let's spend 2 or 3 more minutes on questions and then we'll go for break. Do you still want to show a phase diagram or you already don't have any more?
Yeah, I wanted to show the phase diagram. Yeah, so that's the phase diagram of the cerium 115 systems. And so here is the rhodium case. And here is the cobalt case. And you can see that what's interesting is that the superconductivity here is actually at a maximum at a point where it's furthest away from magnetism. So the iridium has a dome here that looks like it's on the edge of magnetism, but the cobalt seems to be driven by something further away from the magnetic dome. Okay. And this is what makes one think that there might be other pairing mechanisms going on there.
So my question is about the D-wave nature of the pairing. So you made some arguments based on orbital angular momentum of the states, the
yes,
electronic states involved. But as you've mentioned in this tetrahedral crystal field, angular momentum isn't a good quantum number.
Right.
So I'm wondering just
so,
how
so
you admit what sort of...
So but you can classify it according to the way it transforms under crystal rotations. And so the important point is that under 90 degree rotation, it changes sign.
Sure, that's how we define D-wave.
Yes.
So but my question is how does that follow? Could you not, is that the only way to make composite pairing in this sort of model?
You see, there seem to be two questions that you're asking here. One is about the connection of the composite pairs with the underlying symmetry of the pair. And then the second question is this the only way to make a composite pair?
So I understand that you can...
Sorry. Let's ask the second question. Is it the only way to make a composite pair? Is D-wave the only option?
Oh, no.
That was the question.
Yeah, so the first point is that because of the constraint, you'll always want to have a node in the order parameter. That's very important to this here. But in principle, you could imagine other forms of composite pairing going on. First of all, when you say quote-unquote D-wave, since there's an ambiguity because of the crystal symmetry, you could have mixtures of D and, I guess, G-wave pairing altogether without breaking the crystal symmetry. And that's what this thing does. It has a very exotic-looking thing that has octahedral things as well as D-wave-like-looking things. But the second question is this the only way of doing this? Absolutely not. There are lots of interesting aspects to this kind of composite pairing going on here, one of which I haven't mentioned at all, which is it has a very large odd frequency component to it. And in the region where the Fermi surface disappears, it becomes entirely odd frequency, in fact, at that point.
Do you have a question?
No.
Okay, then probably we need to go.
Okay,
great. Thanks very much.
Cheers.